And we welcome you to Super Tuesday, presented by Cree LED Lighting as a part of Bracket Builder Week, presented by Dish. Our matchup from the Coliseum, Texas on the road to take on number 20, West Virginia. Kansas losing last night at Kansas State. The Mountaineers just a game back in the loss column in this ultra-competitive Big 12 conference. Starting lineups, Miles, we will begin with the Longhorns of Texas.
Kendall Yancey's been the best player for the Longhorns over the last two games, 21 and a half points per game for the sophomore. And then for West Virginia, Jawan Staten, the reigning Big 12 player of the week, 17 points per game, 6 assists over his last four, 3 of those being victories.
He had a great week, and West Virginia as a team had a tremendous week. They beat Kansas right here on this floor a week ago, went on the road to Stillwater and beat a top 25 Oklahoma State team. So now inside the Coliseum, where it will be rocking, a tough test for the Texas Longhorns, and the opening tap controlled by West Virginia.
Well, the thing you notice right away with the Texas Longhorns is the change in the starting lineup. Connor Lambert gets the start over DeMarcus Holland. They go bigger. DeMarcus Holland had started every game so far for the Longhorns this season.
So going big, Texas, they have a huge size advantage over the undersized Mountaineers. And also in that zone, Holton gets his shot blocked, and that'll be a theme tonight. Texas blocks more shots than any team in college basketball.
Yes, 7.5 blocks per game. Last week against Oklahoma, had 13 blocks in a game that I had.
And these two teams met in Austin earlier this year. That's a whistle and a foul against Gary Brown. Fouls can be a big-time problem for West Virginia. It was a mismatch in Austin. Texas really took it to West Virginia. Mountaineers' worst performance, worst loss of the year.
Yeah, and a theme in that game, there was a ton of fouls by the Mountaineers. Three guys fouled out. But they really had trouble scoring over the size of this Longhorn team.
Texas with the ball for the first time. Isaiah Taylor, their very talented sophomore guard, has not had a great year. It's been an injury-plagued season. Taylor still really trying to get it going. Picked up his dribble and gets rid of the ball. Bob Huggins cannot believe that wasn't a 5-second violation. Shot clock winding down. There's Taylor on the move, and he scores off the glass.
And there's where Taylor really excels. He doesn't, not a great jump shooter, only 30% from the arc, but he can use pick and rolls, use his size, his length, and his speed to get into the paint.
You see the numbers from his game on Saturday, and Iowa State win in Austin. The overall numbers were good. The efficiency still not where Texas wants it. Devin Williams, one of the better big men of the Big 12 this year.
And one reason that Texas did go with the big lineup so they can play their zone, it's something that has given West Virginia problems. Taylor played the zone, Texas in the first matchup, but they're able to navigate, get the ball inside, and get the nice finish, and now set up the pressure.
Jonathan Holton.
And on the other end of the floor for the Longhorns, taking Holland out of the game, you lose one ball handler against this press, but it's the pass not delivered on the money by Yancey to Ridley.
Not a bad idea. And on the ground, Devin Williams is hurting behind the play. Man, he is in some pain and maybe got hit in the face, the nose, mouth. This was that lob play. Williams stepped in to try to take a charge. There wasn't a whistle, but a lot of contact.
And well, it looks like Cameron Ridley's left foot came down on top of Devin Williams there.
That is a big left foot.
Yeah, as we see it again, Williams down, tries to take the charge.
Ouch.
And it looks like it catches him on the side of the face and maybe a little bit banging the back of his head.
I mean, Cameron Ridley, he's one of the bigger players in the country.
Ridley stands 6'9", 285 pounds.
And Williams is a very tough kid, averaging better than 10 points a game. Second leading rebounder in the conference. He comes out, although it looks like only for a moment. Elijah Macon is in the game.
Well, with Williams out of the game, they lose their best rebounder, second leading scorer.
Pass, Miles catches, and a nice bounce pass down low. Holton with those shot blockers all around him couldn't get a shot off. Here's Jawan Staten fouled, and I think that will be a shooting foul. Well, I say that, but I think they're going to. I still haven't seen the indication of the two foul shots, and in fact, they're going to make West Virginia inbound the ball.
Well, that's a bad call because Jawan Staten was going into a shooting motion to shoot the floater right inside the lane. He should be going to the line for two.
Jerry Brown just got knocked down by Ridley on the inbound play. No call there. West Virginia, look, if the officials let him play, let him be physical, the Mountaineers are going to be okay with that.
Yeah, they want to bump, grind you a little bit, be a physical team, knock you off your spot, be able to put a ton of pressure, sometimes put their hands on you. It'll be advantage for West Virginia depending on how this game is called. And Devin Williams back in the game quickly.
Yeah, so that's good news for West Virginia. Tough contested shot. Staten over the zone defense. Rebound. Texas saves it in bounds.
And that's exactly what Texas wants. They want the 5'11 Juwan Staten. Sorry, the 6 foot Juwan Staten shooting over 6'9 Connor Lambert.
Well, defense will be a theme in this game. You got maybe the best pressure defensive team in the country in West Virginia, certainly one of the best half-court defensive teams in the country in Texas, and that is a five-second violation. And Rick Barnes is going to call a timeout. So it's not a violation. I guess they got the timeout in time. We'll take a timeout ourselves from Morgantown. Dave Fleming, Miles Simon in Morgantown, Texas needed a timeout to avoid a turnover, having some problems with the pressure. Miles, here's how they prepared.
Yeah, here was their preparation. They go eight guys on the defensive end of the floor to try to prepare for this West Virginia press and the swarming defense that they're going to see from the Mountaineers.
So far, that preparation has not paid off. The lead pass to Gary Brown for the transition layup.
This West Virginia team just speeds you up, forces you into mistakes. Just like that one, the offensive foul there by Isaiah Taylor. It's a team that gets 11 and a half steals per game. That's number one in the nation. 21.8 turnovers, points per game off of turnovers, which is the most among major conference teams.
And Rick Barnes is not happy with Taylor, who has to go to the bench. He's already got two fouls on the inbound play. Mountaineers have the basketball.
Remember, this West Virginia team has revenge on their mind. I mean, Texas really manhandled them down in Austin, beat them by 27 points down there.
And that's been a theme these last two seasons. Nice move, finish with the left hand from Devin Williams.
Dave, I was able to be at practice yesterday, and Coach Huggins and his staff spent about 15 to 20 minutes, and now another push off, an offensive foul on DeMarcus Holland.
So that's two in a row. Texas pushing off, bothered by that pressure defense.
And what's interesting is usually we've covered West Virginia a couple times. They don't usually get those calls. They usually get the holding and the grabbing calls going against them. Good sign for the Mountaineers early.
And they are really doing some work right underneath the basket against the big guys for the Longhorns. It's 8-2 Mountaineers. And more problems for Texas inbounding the ball. Trap comes to Holland. So they do get it across midcourt. Now you got to battle the pressure in the half court. And I think that's the thing. They're going to call Gary Brown for a foul here. That'll be his second and send us to a timeout. We're going to talk more about this West Virginia pressure when we come back. 8-2 Mountaineers.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is
8-2, 20th ranked West Virginia with an early lead over Texas here in Morgantown. Dave Fleming, Miles Simon, happy to have you with us tonight already, Miles. I mean, we call this West Virginia team the best pressure defense team in the country, and already that pressure is clearly bothering the Longhorns.
Yeah, the defense is clearly energized and activated tonight. They forced four turnovers, two of them being offensive fouls. Isaiah Taylor's on the bench now with two fouls early in this game, and West Virginia, a lot at stake, especially with Kansas losing last night. They moved to within one game of the top spot in the loss column of the Kansas Jayhawks and the Iowa State Cyclones, and they have the Jayhawks next week at Fog Allen Fieldhouse.
Well, look at that number just to illustrate what the pressure has done to Texas so far. We're almost 5 minutes into this game. They have attempted one shot from the field. That's it. Otherwise, it's been turnovers. That pressure defense has kept Texas out of its offense. Now, near steal here. Holland trying to save the ball inbounds. It will be stolen. Extra pass. Staten open. His two is no good. Way off the mark.
Now, something to really watch for, and it happened on this last possession. No true point guard in the game for Texas. DeMarcus Holland had to play point guard when Isaiah Taylor was out for 10 games with the left wrist injury. So he feels comfortable in that spot. He's played some backup minutes. But how are they going to handle with Taylor on the bench for a majority of this half now? And let's see how Rick Barnes manages Taylor's minutes and fouls going forward.
Yeah, Lambert will come out and maybe to get an extra ball handler in there. Javon Felix comes in for the first time. He's a capable perimeter player. Maybe not a traditional point guard, but he'll be asked to handle a lot of the pressure. Felix, that's a blocking foul against Carter. So here come the whistles.
Felix did a good job. And Felix did a good job of trying to attack right there. Because the West Virginia guards are extended in full denial, it leaves some driving lanes.
And I do think if you don't attack against West Virginia, you lose.
Yeah, you can't be passive against this team. Now, Rick Barnes did talk to us earlier at shoot-around today, saying he wanted his players to invite double teams, be able to get out of it, and then be able to attack with a numbers advantage. And Holland smoothly does it right there, gets to the Big 12 symbol and knocks down the pull-up jump shot.
So just the second basket for Texas, down 8-4. About 5.5 minutes in, Nathan Adrian. Off the bench. A near three-point attempt, and maybe it should have been a shot from Jayshon Page.
Well, besides that possession, West Virginia has handled that zone very well so far, getting the ball inside for a majority of their buckets.
Wild shot by Felix, and then Prince Ibe over the back commits a foul. You were talking about the stakes for West Virginia, just a game back in the loss column. For Rick Barnes' team, there's some huge stakes here tonight as well. Look, 399 wins just in Austin alone. Great track record, a lot of success with this program. This year, though, big expectations. And right now, Texas is close to being a bubble NCAA tournament team.
Yeah, with the way they stand, they're 6-8 in conference, obviously 4 games left. There has been only one team in Big 12 history, and that was Oklahoma State last year, that has gotten to the NCAA tournament with a losing record.
So the Longhorns may still have some work to do to make sure they at least get a spot in the tournament. Staten down the lane, over the shot blocker, tip in good by Williams.
And because Staten was able to drive the gap right there and get the Longhorn defender to help over, that left an offensive rebound opportunity on the weak side.
Kendall Yancey, whose scoring has gone way up in the last couple weeks, hits his first shot of the game.
He's been so good, 21.5 points per game over his last two, shooting the three at a 47% clip in those games. He told us today his confidence is at an all-time high, and he really credited Coach Barnes and Coach Lanier as guys that are helping him improve his game and how much confidence they instill in him.
Well, and the compliment was returned by Rick Barnes, because he thinks Kendall Yancey has a chance to be a really great player his last 2 years of eligibility at Texas.
He really emphasized what a hard worker that Kendall Yancey is. He said when the times he was struggling in part of January and into February is that he was kind of trying too hard when Taylor came back, kind of forcing the issue, but he's much more relaxed now and letting the game come to him.
Texas with the defensive rebound. Down just 4, despite some things that have not gone well in the first 7 minutes of this game.
Let's see if they can get the freshman number 52, Miles Turner, involved here.
Turner in for the first time. That was a lob attempt for Ibe, and a nice outlet to Staten from Carter.
And see, what I don't like that light right there, it's a live ball turnover. You have three guards on the floor. When one of them penetrates, either Yancey or Felix or Holland, they have to be the two guys rotating back right there. Should never be a breakaway, a 1-on-0 opportunity for the Mountaineers.
Well, somebody's got to go back. And there was nobody there that time for Texas. Ibe, who's not a skilled offensive player, good defensive player, trapped on the baseline, and he stepped out of bounds.
Macon and Holton did a good job of just swarming Ibe, making him turn his back to the offensive players. He couldn't see anybody, and he stepped out of bounds. And we see Rick Barnes now. He can't take any chances. He, with the offense not running smoothly, he brings Isaiah Taylor back in with the two fouls.
Look at that turnover, number 7 already for Texas. West Virginia's gotten 8 of their points with a chance to get 2 more here. Maybe 3 more. Staten passed up the 3. He'll take the 2, hits the 2.
And I like what he did.
He didn't catch the ball cleanly, so he didn't force the three. Got a couple rhythm dribbles, got himself to a range that he feels comfortable, and knocks down the shot.
Isaiah Taylor with the two fouls is back in for Texas. You gotta be careful about pushing off on the offensive end. Yancey, meanwhile, hounded by Carter. Taylor tried to find Turner. It's out of bounds, and another turnover. Big night here in Morgantown. They're gonna name the new Mountaineer mascot, and our own Miles Simon, he threw his name into the hat. We'll talk about that when we come back.
We're going to see if I have what it takes to become the next West Virginia Mountaineer mascot.
So first, Miles, we're going to ask you to fill out an application for us.
See, nothing up my sleeves, no cheating.
After that, we want to see you in person. We want to see how you interview with us.
Well, I mean, it's so obvious. I bleed gold and blue. Since growing up in Southern California along the beaches, I've always wanted to come to Morgantown and be the Mountaineer mascot.
The final four process, which is the cheer off.
Mountaineer Nation right there.
And that's why they have one of the best fan bases in all of college basketball.
Well, I'm not sure I ever thought I'd see you wearing a raccoon on top of your head, Miles. But somehow it suited you. You came in early to throw your hat into the ring.
I did. And I really had a great time with the selection committee members, Derek and George. And then that's my man right there, Michael Garcia. He's in the Final Four tonight to continue his reign as the Mountaineer mascot.
Yeah, now see, I didn't know that you could have a second term as a Mountaineer.
You can.
Does not necessarily change.
It's a yearly thing. The statue that I was standing by outside is in reflection of supposed to be Jerry West. Jerry West, a very popular man, obviously, in Morgantown. He's also the logo in the NBA. But I really had a fun experience yesterday interacting with all those guys.
It is a big deal on campus, and we're just minutes away from that announcement of foul. Bucket for Elijah Bacon, and man, West Virginia is really going after this Texas defense.
Well, West Virginia has done a tremendous job of not settling for jump shots against this zone defense. They're pounding the ball on the inside. That's now their 14th of 16 of their 16 points have come in the painted area, mostly at the rim. The one Juwan State jumper is the only thing outside of the key that they've gotten.
Elijah Bacon, redshirt freshman, completes the three-point play. West Virginia, they'll press on a make, on a miss. They'll press all the time, but particularly on a made free throw gives them a chance to set things up.
Well, and that was one problem in the game in Austin, is that they couldn't score the ball, so they couldn't get into their pressure. They shot a season low 24% from the field in that game.
In Texas, before this possession, 12 times they've had the ball, 8 times they've turned it over. Holmes open, 3 no good, and a long rebound for the Mountaineers.
Holmes is a guy that has to get going for this Longhorn team if they're going to have any sustained long-term success for the rest of the season. He's really struggled since he's come back from his concussion.
He had a great year last year and a good start to this season. And things since then just have not gone well. Miles! Dexter Miles hits a three.
Dexter Miles, the freshman from Baltimore, Maryland. Didn't qualify out of high school, had went to Dunbar High School, then spent some time at Notre Dame Prep, but he's a guy that Coach Bob Huggins is tremendously high on.
Miles Turner, the very talented freshman for the Longhorns, hits the basket to momentarily quiet the crowd and end the 10-0 run.
And that's one of his sweet spots, about 15 to 17 feet. He faces you up, and with that size at 6'11 and the high release point, it's hard to get to in the beautiful soft touch.
He's playing well.
West Virginia spent quite a lot of time yesterday in practice going over their zone offense. So far, been tremendously effective.
Shot clock starting to wind down. Make a nice look for Holton down low, rejected by eBay. Jonathan Holmes, a player that Miles was just talking about, and they need more offense from him. Taylor playing with those two fouls.
Lob finished by Ibe.
They worked on that exact option for about 10 minutes today in their shoot-around. Guards driving, throwing the lob. Once the big man steps up to try to take a charge and stop the drive, executed perfectly by Taylor.
Under 9 minutes to go, first half. 10-point lead for West Virginia. A couple encouraging possessions in a row, though, for Texas. Macon couldn't handle the pass down low, stolen away. Taylor wants a screen from Miles Turner. Down the lane and another lob. This time Ibe couldn't dunk it home. And the ball goes to the Mountaineers.
Once again, executed perfectly. He delivered it on the money. And I don't know if Ibe just took his eyes off the rim for a split second. But every basket's going to need to count for the Longhorn tonight.
Yeah, you got to finish that one. That was a dunk. Carter three. Good. And what a swing that was those last couple possessions.
Jamon Carter, another freshman from Proviso East High School, same school that produced D. Brown, Shannon Brown, Michael Finley, and Doc Rivers.
Nice scoring night against Kansas in the win just last week on this court. Another Texas turnover, and Bob Huggins has to be happy with the way this game is going.
Well, the West Virginia Mountaineers were getting it done in the paint early, but now it's been back-to-back threes by Carter and Miles, giving them the lead.
Ranked Kansas. The Jayhawks, of course, lost last night in Manhattan. The fans storming the court afterwards. Really a dangerous situation. I do give Kansas State some credit. Their athletic director issued an apology today. I'm not sure unfortunate situation is the exact way that I would describe what happened. It was scary after the game, but a great win for the Wildcats.
Well, just fortunate that no one got hurt. We saw the video of Jamari Traylor getting bumped, Bill Self getting swarmed. Bruce Weber tried to do his best to get the fans out of the way, but there needed to be better security by Kansas State last night, especially you knew the storm was coming. It happened last year. You're up by 4, 5, 6 points with 15, 20 seconds left to go. Better security should have been in place before it happened.
Well, when West Virginia beat Kansas here last week, they fans stormed the court. After that win against the Jayhawks, everybody was safe, no problem whatsoever.
And it should have been an easy thing, especially at Kansas State, because the visitor's bench is very close to the tunnel there. If you can get enough security in front of the Kansas people and usher them off the court, wouldn't have been a problem.
Well, that's going to count as another turnover against Texas. That'll be number 10. We are 13 minutes into this game. They've turned the ball over 10 times.
Well, the West Virginia pressure has been obviously tremendous tonight. They've been all over the floor. They've had active hands. They've moved their feet really well, gotten deflections.
If you finish a game with the same number of points as turnovers, that's not going to be good. Hayden Adrian, the hometown kid, it's a nice free throw area jumper.
The Morgantown native, Morgantown High School, just a few minutes here from the campus. Adrian's a guy they need to make more three-point shots. That's a bonus right there that he makes one in the middle of the lane, but he was a great three-point shooter last year. Very good at 36%, but only 16 this year, and the nice drive and finish there by the Longhorns.
Well, when Texas can actually get a shot off, they're making their shots. They're 6 of 9 as a team from the field. They just can't get shots off. Staten for three. In and out, no good. Cameron Ridley back in the game with a nice defensive rebound, and then he almost traveled. Now that double team, Carter called for the reach-in.
Well, you see what's so unique about this press, that West Virginia on a made shot. We've obviously seen the full court pressure, but what's different is that even on misses, whether it's free throw misses or jump shot misses, they have guys that kind of hang around. They don't necessarily have man-to-man assignments necessarily after the ball is missed, and they get into that pressure and still try to cause havoc.
I saw Kendall Yancey grimacing a little bit, holding his left shoulder, left upper chest. Sort of what you're talking about. They will pressure and double team and trap in any situation. Miles got his hands on the ball, stole it away. Page trailing. Page missed the shot. Adrian comes away with the ball though. Miles by Ridley, who's fouled. And they're going to say a passing on the floor foul, not a shooting foul.
But West Virginia is in the bonus, so free throws coming up.
Dave, you and I were talking to Coach Huggins a few weeks ago when we covered the Mountaineers game, and we were asking what the ceiling was for this team, and he feels that they can definitely be a second weekend team, especially if they can get by their first game in the NCAA tournament, and you only have a one-day turnaround to try to prepare for this pressure, and if it's something that the other team most likely hasn't seen all season, it's not as if the team they would play in the second game could take a full practice and do 30 or 35 minutes going full court against pressure, because you have to try to save your legs. So really, this West Virginia team could be a dangerous NCAA tournament team in that sense.
Well, how about we just say this? On Selection Sunday, when teams around the country watching who they're matched up with in the first round, even in that first round, whoever pops up opposite West Virginia is not going to be happy.
No, they're not, because it's a deep, physical team, and if they're scoring the ball like they did at Oklahoma State, where they made 10 out of 23s, they're already a great offensive rebounding team. They force a lot of turnovers. Tonight, they've been very good against the zone on the offensive end. It's going to be a struggle to beat West Virginia. They have 9 assists on 11 field goals already tonight in the first 15 minutes.
They play like this on offense, and they can beat anybody. They're just so different. They're different than every other team in the country. Yancey dribbles through the pressure.
And look how far Texas has to start their offense. I mean, they're starting their offense 10 to 12 feet behind the three-point line on nearly every possession, because every pass is denied. There's always a 5 count on, so you're worried about that. So many different things you have to concentrate on facing this Mountaineer team.
Now here's where Texas can get some things done. They start to draw some fouls, get into the bonus, make some shots at the line. The Longhorns lived at the free throw line in the first matchup between these two teams, which was a dominant Texas win. Holmes, little pass fake, and hits the three. Big shot for him, big shot for Texas.
Huge. If that could be a confidence booster for Jonathan Holmes, who was only 2 for 10 from behind the arc since coming back from the concussion a few games ago. But here's where Texas has to get better. They got to start taking away the paint, trying to force West Virginia into a jump shooting team.
Adrian hits a three. Happened a lot this year. He's a good shooter. He's had a horrible shooting year. Now a foul against Page with the pressure defense. Taylor will be the free throw shooter now. The Longhorns are the bonus.
But you know one thing Bob Huggins does? He instills a lot of confidence in his guys. And he has continued to tell Nathan Adrian to keep shooting that basketball, because Adrian proved last year that he can be a capable three-point shooter. As the hometown native, he's going to take a quick breather.
Yeah, that's why I say he has a track record of being able to make shots from the outside. It's just been a nightmare this year for him. Taylor at the free throw line misses the front end, but the ball goes out of bounds off of Williams. So it'll be Texas basketball. Sunday on SportsCenter, Texas hoop star Imani Stafford, who has escaped a troubled pass. That was not easy. Rebound by Williams as they're back to action. But SC Featured presents Her Voice all day Sunday on SportsCenter. You won't want to miss it. Remarkable story of a remarkable young woman. Here's Staten. Phillip will shoot a three. Holton offensive rebound out of bounds off of Texas. So no foul, but the Mountaineers will keep it.
Well, you see Holton getting that offensive rebound. Jonathan Holton's points per game are down in conference play. From his overall total, only 4 points per game at conference, but he gets about 2.5 offensive rebounds per game.
Well, when he can stay on the floor, he's an impact player.
Yeah, he's a total energy guy. He is a vocal leader on this team, and he's kind of the guy that sets the tone for this press.
Rebound by Holmes. I mean, even just getting the ball dribbled, even starting to get it up the court, has not been easy for the Longhorns.
And eventually it just kind of becomes a pain in your side, because it's relentless and it's all the time. Someone kind of, just imagine me being in your face like for 40 straight minutes, Dave, and just talking to you and having my hands around you. It makes you feel truly uncomfortable, just like right there, the double team, no one to throw the ball to.
the anticipators, as Juwan Staten would be right there, was in the perfect position, and Taylor had no one to pass to. You see the trap, the long arms. They don't foul. They move their feet. And then all the other guys are in the perfect position to make a defensive play.
I do like you, partner, but I'm happy just a couple feet away. That's good. It's a little separation. 12 Texas turnovers with still 4 minutes to go in the half. Holton from the corner. Three goes in. Man, everything's going right for the Mountaineers.
Holton, the junior college transfer from Palm Beach State Community College, actually a 39% shooter at the junior college level from behind the arc.
Holton, who can be a real pest in these traps. He's so long. Yancey to Taylor. Now Yancey from the corner hits a big three.
That really was a big three because Yancey was stuck along the sideline. Sideline was used as a third defender there. Isaiah Taylor came and was able to get that basketball, get a little penetration and a nice kick out.
It looked like a disastrous possession for Texas. And it ends in 3 points. There's still a long way to go in this game. The game is not over. West Virginia really playing well in this first half. Williams bounces it to Staten. Shot clock winding down, and West Virginia's not going to get a shot off. So that's a rare Mountaineers turnover. Sends us to a timeout. 33-18, West Virginia leads.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college.
A big night in Morgantown. Michael Garcia was elected as the Mountaineer mascot for next year. He's already been the Mountaineer this year. He was pumped, so he's going to do it again next season. The problem is my partner was trying to become the next Mountaineer. Sorry, Miles.
I'm truly disappointed. I thought I had a legit chance this year. I put my heart and soul into it. It was a dream of mine to be the Mountaineer mascot, but it wasn't to be. Congratulations to Michael Garcia.
Can I touch that thing?
Absolutely.
This is real.
Yeah,
very natural.
You see how I went from 5 o'clock shadow to full beard. I'm more than capable.
Very impressed by your beard growing ability. Michael Garcia, he is pumped. He's got the real musket there. And he was sort of your host yesterday, right?
He was, and he's a tremendous young man, and he represents the university at the highest level, and I was proud to hang with him yesterday for a couple hours. And now, it is not a prerequisite to have the beard, I found out yesterday. There has been two female Mountaineer mascots, most recently in 2009.
Jonathan Holmes with a three. So the Mountaineers celebrating in lots of different ways, but Texas trying to hang in this game. 33-21, West Virginia, about two-plus minutes to go in the half.
Well, as you said earlier, the problem hasn't been when they've gotten shots because they're shooting 9-for-13 from the field. Problem is they have 12 turnovers, which has led to 20 points for the Mountaineers.
When's the last time you saw a team 18 minutes into a game shooting 69% and getting hammered? Long rebound. Miles comes up with it. Miles down the lane with the follow.
Miles Jr.
Texas got to get the ball inbounds. Barely did that. Ridley down low with the dunk. So that time they got the mismatch after the double team, and Ridley took advantage. He's been quiet, though, for the most part in this first half. Chase Connor, who does not play much, is in the game for West Virginia. And he's shooting an NBA range three. So the walk-on feeling very confident into the game, but he misses the three.
Well, and that's pretty much what he's in there for. He's 40% from behind the arc on the season.
Holland to the basket. Nice move from DeMarcus Holland.
But there's where they get hurt when Connor's in the game. He's not great defensively. He's not able to move his feet as well as some of the other guards. And Bob Huggins wants to get a timeout as the Horns have made a little mini run here in the last minute and a half.
So 10-point lead for West Virginia. I think Rick Barnes, Miles, has to be at least encouraged by these last couple of minutes. I may not be happy with some of the officiating. He can't be happy with the overall first half. But Texas is still in this game despite all the turnover problems.
Well, I think a couple positives is that they're going to probably get out of the first half with Isaiah Taylor not having picked up his third foul, and that Jonathan Holmes has made a couple threes after being in such a big slump as of late.
They're shooting 73%. Texas is the team that's down 10, shooting 73%.
But it's almost as if you don't face this type of pressure on a daily basis in practice, that it takes you a few minutes, in this case, a lot more than a few for Texas, to get comfortable against this press and have confidence in breaking it and attacking it. And that's what Texas has done as of late.
Well, Taylor with his fouls on the bench. Not going to be a 2-for-1 attempt by West Virginia. And they can't hold for the final shot unless they get an offensive rebound. Senior point guard Staten has the ball. Shot clock under 10. Connor will shoot another three. Again, in and out, no good. Now a whistle, and I think a foul's been called against West Virginia. Now Devin Williams getting into it with somebody on the bench with Texas. Williams is unhappy. Bob Huggins raced out there. I don't think he thought the officials were paying attention to what was going on. It was almost like somebody from Texas was coming off the bench to engage Williams. We'll see if we can see what happened here. Williams and Holmes getting into it.
And Williams approached Holmes. They had some words with each other first there, and then Williams stepped into the face of Jonathan Holmes. Oh, the Williams, that's an illegal pick. Whoa. You see the forearm, and then you see the elbow or the forearm by Jonathan Holmes.
Now they're going to look at this on the monitor, and they missed a shove by Williams in the back, but that's not a reviewable play. The elbow thrown to the face, I mean, they could hit Jonathan Holmes here, and that could be, to me, that could be a flagrant two. That has a chance to kick Jonathan Holmes out of this game.
Devin Williams initiated the action. He set the flare screen, and on the first action, he extended his arms. They probably missed a moving pick or an illegal screen in that sense. And then Jonathan Holmes with the retaliation. You know,
man,
that was just the retaliation right there.
Now, I don't know if that will elevate to the level of a flagrant two, but after the push, it's at least the kind of play, the type of play, where I think an official could interpret it as that. So that's what they're looking at here. Let's watch the whole sequence again just to get an understanding of what went on.
You're going to watch Jonathan Williams come to the left side of your screen. And there he extends. He knocks Jonathan Holmes over. And then Holmes retaliates clearly with the forearm or elbow to the head or neck area of Devin Williams.
I mean, that was not a basketball play. But Jonathan Holmes has to know that he could be in trouble here. Just a quick review. After a call is made on the floor, you can do a certain number of things. But with no call made on the floor, you can't go back and say common foul. What you can do is say a flagrant foul was committed that we missed, and that's what the officials are looking at right here. And it could be a flagrant one, or it could be a flagrant two. And really, I would not be shocked if that's a flagrant two against Jonathan Holmes. Going to talk about this with the coaches, and Rick Barnes is not happy about something. Now that we don't know what they've told either coach yet, there was to me a foul that was called that stopped action. I think that foul was against West Virginia. We haven't gone back and looked at the sequence after this that we've been focusing on. I think you can see why both players were unhappy with what went on.
And
Gary Maxwell's going to come over and talk to us and explain what's happening.
Okay, we've got a personal foul on one White on the rebound play, foul 55. We have a flagrant 2 on 10 Texas. He's checked.
Well, and we do appreciate that communication from the officials, and you can see what has happened. It is a flagrant 2 against Jonathan Holmes. He is ejected from the game. There was a foul earlier in the sequence, which will mean free throws for Ridley. Foul on West Virginia, Jonathan Holton. So Ridley will shoot free throws. After that, West Virginia will get 2 free throws for the flagrant foul against Holmes, and West Virginia will have the ball for the final 20 seconds of this first half. And Miles, it's hard to disagree with the decision from the officials. You watch that replay, and that looked to me like a clear flagrant 2 foul.
Yeah, and if you look up the definition of the flagrant 2 personal foul, it's a foul that involves contact with an opponent that is not only excessive but also severe or extreme. And clearly Jonathan Holmes was searching out Devin Williams because he had got hit in his back on the flare screen and threw the elbow at the head and neck area of Devin Williams.
So, and again, just to clean up what just happened, Ridley went to the line. That was the front end of a 1-and-1, even though it was a dead ball situation. So he only got the 1 free throw. Now it's Williams for 2, and he misses the first. Just one more look at what they called. There was the shove by Williams. It wasn't called, but then that elbow, that was the flagrant 2, and I think it's really the definition of the rule, and by rule, Jonathan Holmes is out of this game.
And what a huge loss for the Texas Longhorns. Guy who's made 2 threes is getting his confidence back for this team, and he's the only senior that plays for the Longhorn team.
Now, presumably, West Virginia will want to hold for the final shot. Again, it's interesting that Chase Connor is in for these final few moments. But it'll be Juwan Staten, preseason Big 12 Player of the Year, the point guard with the clock down to 5. Staten to Connor, shoots another 3, and that one is too long. Long rebound goes out of bounds. And that is how the first half comes to an end. Devin Williams and the Mountaineers with an 11-point lead. The lead was as big as 18 at one point. So Texas chopped it down a little bit. Rick Barnes still not real happy with what has gone on. Well, we're finished here in just a moment. Coming up, Land Rover Halftime Report with Adnan and Seth. But meanwhile, Miles is with Bob Huggins.
Coach, what were you most pleased with your team in the first half?
I thought our effort was really good. I thought our patience on offense was terrific.
What are you guys going to have to do in the second half to continue to keep this lead and pull out the win?
Make some shots.
Thanks, Coach.
Keep it simple, Bob Huggins. After this break, Adnan and Seth will join you in the studio. It'll be the Land Rover Halftime Report. So we are back here in Morgantown on the Land Rover Halftime Report. West Virginia at home against Texas with the 36-25 halftime lead. Dave Fleming, Miles Simon. Miles, a lot went right for the Mountaineers here at home in the first half against Texas. We talk over and over and over again about their pressure. That defines West Virginia. To me, it defined the first half of this game.
Yeah, it really did. They scored the ball early, which allowed them to get into this pressure and changed and set the whole tone for the basketball game. There you see the steal, the quick hands by the guards of West Virginia leads to the easy run out for Gary Brown as he knocks it down, and then now off the dribble handoff. They trap, they swarm, they anticipate, they get the steal, they convert on the other end. Now a big-to-big double. Prince Ibe has nowhere to go, steps out of bounds. And then just swarming again in the half court. Isaiah Taylor makes the mistake, jumps in the air, turnover again. And that was the biggest difference in the half. You see the 12 forced turnovers led to 20 points. But also this number right here, 29 field goal attempts to 15. Coming into tonight's game, the West Virginia Mountaineers had taken 440 more shots than their opponents, and it's playing true to form tonight.
Texas shot 73% of the first half, and they're down by double digits. Second half, when we come back, this has been the Land Rover Halftime Report.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Dish. Only the Hopper from Dish gives you the power to watch all your live and recorded TV anywhere. And Phillip 66, proud to be here.
And indeed it is a part of Bracket Builder Week presented by Dish. Start of the second half, Texas with a deficit to overcome on the road. West Virginia leads 36-25, and it's not going to be easy. One of their best players, Jonathan Holmes, will not be playing in the second half. Watch the elbow there. If he missed the final moments of the first half, that was called a flagrant two. Holmes ejected from the game. Well, Miles Turner, the freshman, will start this second half of the Longhorns, who do have the ball against the Mountaineers.
And then Jonathan Holmes, you miss your third leading scorer at 10 points per game, your second leading rebounder, one of your best three-point shooters, and the only senior on the roster for the Longhorns.
Well, the one bit of good news for Texas, it could be worse. They were down 18 with under 4 minutes to go in the first half, so they cut into that deficit. Taylor misses the shot. West Virginia, two Mountaineers fight each other for the rebound. Nice outlet to Miles on the attack with the reverse layup, but he missed it.
Good look ahead pass by Juwan Staten, but the freshman Daxter Miles just not able to finish.
Yancey, offensive foul. That counts as another Texas turnover. The Longhorns turned it over on 40% of their possessions in the first half. And Yancey already is going to hear about it from his head coach Rick Barnes. 13 turnovers in the game. That's an astounding percentage. West Virginia turns people over, but this is something even more than that.
Well, these West Virginia guards, in that case, they do a great job of moving their feet, trying to play without their hands as best as possible, and that's what enabled them to get the charge.
Against this Texas zone defense, West Virginia's been efficient. Their offense has been good.
Well, I thought that was the difference early in the game, the way they attacked, and Staten doesn't know the shot clock, because he could have picked that ball up before it probably crossed half court. But they attacked the zone in the first half. They really got the ball on the inside, got easy layups, some dunks, and that allowed the tempo to be set and the tone to be set, because they got into pressure early in this game and took Texas out of anything that they wanted to do.
That number we showed in the first half statistics, 9 different players with at least one assist for West Virginia, so they were passing the ball, all those things you were talking about. But Miles, the freshman, out of the game. Now a foul against Holton, guarding on the perimeter. Well, this game's a long way from being over. 18:34 to go. Texas has been playing from behind the whole way. Nathan Adrian, the sophomore, comes back in for Holton.
And I don't think we can emphasize it enough. I think this game is very important for the Texas Longhorns. They stand 6-8 in conference play right now. Only 3 games left after tonight. Only one team in Big 12 history has gone to the NCAA tournament with a losing conference record, and that was Oklahoma State last year.
Carter underneath the basket gets fouled by Ridley. So West Virginia on the attack very quickly into the front court. The freshman Javon Carter will go to the free throw line. Just to back up that point, West Virginia only a game back in the loss column, maybe one game behind Kansas for first place of the Big 12 if they win this one tonight. So the stakes are high for the Mountaineers in terms of a championship hope in this tough Big 12. But for Texas, really, and we're going to talk to Joe Lunardi coming up here in a few minutes live during our telecast, and we'll ask Joe about the Longhorns and their tournament status. If they lose this game, the schedule is not easy at the finish of the regular season for Rick Barnes and the Longhorns. If they lose this game, I think people in Austin can start to get a little bit nervous.
Yeah, well, definitely have to go to Kansas on Saturday. It's going to be an angry, hostile environment there with Kansas coming off the loss on Monday. A lot on the line for the Jayhawks, obviously, looking to try to continue their conference championship streak and extend it to 11. But then they'll have to play a tough Baylor team who has been very good all season long, so it doesn't get easy for this Longhorn team.
Holland with the defender down on the floor. Holland hits a three. Those shots continue to go in for Texas. The lead is down to eight.
DeMarcus Holland, a much improved three-point shooter, 44% on the season. Mostly known as a defender, but able to knock down the three there.
We're talking about six, close to 7 minutes of game time, and Texas has shaved 10 points off the lead. Here's Gary Brown. He misses the three. Adrian tried to save the ball inbounds, but it's off of Nathan Adrian. So Texas gets it back down on the 8 points. I think Bob Huggins knows that despite everything that's gone well for the Mountaineers, this one's a long way from being over.
Two true ball handlers on the floor for the Longhorns.
Now an advantage after breaking that pressure. Turner misses the shot, but Miles Turner goes to the free throw line. That right there, I think, was textbook of how Rick Barnes wants to attack the press.
Absolutely. Cameron Ridley came and met the pass in the middle of the floor. Strong with the basketball, squared up, found the guard. They attack two on one, and it gets Miles Turner to the line.
One thing you have to love about the freshman big man, how good he is at the free throw line. This is a near 7-footer, and Miles Turner's well above 80% from the line for the year.
Well, he's playing the best basketball all season, 16 and 10 and 3 blocks per game over his last three games, plus nearly shooting 60% in that span.
This is the closest it's been since it was 12 to 6 very early in this game. Texas has been methodical, but they've climbed back in this one.
And you see the Texas players not extending out past the three-point line, daring West Virginia to be a jump-shooting team. The first 4 or 5 minutes of the game against the zone, West Virginia was constantly getting in the paint and at the rim.
How about Taylor? Nice dish to Ridley for the dunk. And he almost landed right on Devin Williams. The lead is down to 4.
And the Longhorns' confidence now at an all-time high. Great job by Isaiah Taylor probing the defense. Cameron Ridley making himself available for the throwdown, and the Longhorns have made this one a game.
Well, Bob Huggins and West Virginia call a timeout, so we'll step aside ourselves, but a whole different game here in Morgantown. MVP in the NBA this year, Bob Huggins not happy with the last few minutes. Texas going back to the last stages of the first half on a 19-5 run. And the Longhorns are as close as they've been since the very early moments of the game. Williams gets a touch inside with the left hand. He scores.
I like the after timeout offense that Bob Huggins' team runs. They execute it perfectly. Now able to set up the pressure and get the steal.
What a great play by Javon Carter to steal that ball away and then save it inbounds.
Tremendous anticipation.
Staten passed up the three. Williams gets another touch.
I know they're looking to pass in the high post, but Brown or Staten, they can look to penetrate this zone also.
State and three, and it's way off the mark. Rebound Taylor in Texas. Now the Longhorns survive at least the first wave of pressure. And when they've been in the half court, they have been an excellent offensive team tonight.
I'd love to see Turner get a touch, and there it is.
He got a touch, and he almost hit the three. Now a foul on West Virginia, fighting for rebounding position. So when we come back here to Morgantown, the Longhorns will have the... Dave Fleming, Miles Simon back here in Morgantown, where the Coliseum has gone quiet in the last few minutes. Texas is on a run. Now they're still down 6, but Rick Barnes has to like what he has seen from the Longhorns in these last few minutes of play. 15:23 to go. 40-34 is the score. West Virginia had a great week last week. Miles, 20th ranked team in the country, playing really well. Texas is desperate. They need a win here tonight. Otherwise, these last couple weeks are going to become a lot more stressful, I think, for the Longhorns and their fans. not just positioning for the NCAA tournament, but are they even in the NCAA tournament? West Virginia is going to get there. They have a chance to be an even higher seed than they would be if the tournament started tonight. So there's a lot on the line here tonight in Morgantown.
Yeah, when you look at the Texas resume, I mean, of the six wins that they have in conference, five of them are against the three teams that are sitting in eighth, ninth, and tenth place in the Big 12. So this could be a quality road win if Texas is able to come back and pull off the upset.
Fresh shot clock after a foul before the last timeout. So Longhorns have the ball, playing without Jonathan Holmes. He was called for a flagrant two foul. Taylor with the left-hand finish.
Taylor's so good. If you start to let him get downhill, they get the flat ball skein right there. He pretty much rejects it, able to get to that left hand and all the way to the rim.
A four-point game. Mountaineers with the ball and the lead. They led by as many as 18 in the first half. Dayton tried to bounce pass down low, not a good pass, stolen away.
Well, that Texas defense has really settled in. They come into this game one of the best defensive teams in all of college basketball, fourth in the nation in field goal percentage defense.
Holland was feeling it, not a great shot. Rebound, sort of clanging around, and finally the Mountaineers come away with the ball.
That was a force. You almost didn't need it, and it might cost you at this end.
Adrian's shot was partially blocked. Great hustle by Holland coming back on defense. Now Holland runs the floor in this direction and draws a foul.
And Nathan Adrian with the slow release there, it was as if he didn't have his feet set. He tried to find the three-point line, and then by the time that happened, it was too late to get the shot off. And then Texas in a full sprint to the other end. Taylor with a nice pass to Holland.
Yeah, there are slow releases, and then there was that. Adrian just took forever to get that shot off, and it cost him. He was wide open. Ridley's going to come out. Prince Ibe will check into the game for the Longhorns, but it's down to three with one more free throw coming for DeMarcus Holland, who did not start this game for the first time all year, but has played very well, I think.
You know what, and that's a sign of maturity for DeMarcus Holland, that he's putting the team above himself. He's come out, played hard, played the right way, and was ready to go when his number's called. A lot of credit to that young man. Some guys can't take a demotion like that.
Brown on the perimeter against this zone. West Virginia, those good looks not coming as easily. Adrian baseline. Another shot was deflected, this time by Ibe.
Well, these guys just cover so much ground. Prince Ibe right there, and then another transition opportunity.
Ibe fouled on the dunk attempt after Turner couldn't finish. Prince Ibe will go to the free throw line.
And that could end up being a good foul by West Virginia, because Prince Ibe only 11 for 30 on the season from the foul line.
If he's got it down low, you got to do whatever you can to keep him from getting a shot off and making him earn it at the free throw line. It's not a pretty look at the line for Ibe.
And you can see he just doesn't have a lot of confidence. He's trying to shoot it with a lot of arc, which in hope should give it a better chance to go in, because the ball gets to see more of the rim on the way down. But he doesn't hold his follow through, and he kind of flicks it up there at the rim.
Second one on the way for Ibe, and this time perfect. So he makes one of two. For Texas, that's a victory. That's unusual, Miles, because we thought it could be a backbreaker for Texas. But since Jonathan Holmes was kicked out of this game with the flagrant two, Longhorns have outscored West Virginia 13-4.
And what was kind of a frenetic pace in the first half, because West Virginia was setting the tempo. They were able to score, get into their pressure. The game has settled down into a half-court game, which is an advantage for Texas. As Javon Carter able to knock down the three, they had good ball movement side to side against the zone.
Fifth made three for the Mountaineers. Carter has two of them.
You see West Virginia backing off the pressure, now going to his own defense. Little 1-1-3 action by the Mountaineers.
Now that's unusual. As West Virginia, for the most part, they do not change what they do on the defensive end. Taylor tried to find Ibe. Loose ball. Who's going to come up with it? Lambert battling with Williams, and they're going to say jump ball. I don't know. No, shot clock violation. So before the jump ball, shot clock expires. West Virginia hustle, and the fans appreciate it.
Well, the good hustle, just a loose ball. You love to see guys diving, sacrificing their bodies, and you see the shot clock get to double zeros before any possession was retained. But I think one reason why Bob Huggins goes to the zone there is just to kind of change the tempo of the offense that Texas was running. Texas was in a total flow against the man offense, getting what they wanted in transition, getting what they wanted off ball screens, and it worked to perfection.
How about Stadney switch to the left hand, and then Miles Turner with the goal 10. So count that basket for the senior Juwan Stadney.
Juwan Stadney, he's one of the best athletes in this conference. You see, he goes up, switches hands, tries to get the English off the glass, but the goaltender is called.
The crowd at the Coliseum has come to life. Turner couldn't handle the pass. Went right off his hands.
It's amazing. Whatever defense West Virginia goes to causes turnovers.
Yeah.
Two possessions of zone, two turnovers by the Longhorns.
Cooled off some of Texas's momentum. Carter, good shot fake.
This was the group that was effective in the first half against the zone, especially Holton. Holton and Williams in there at the high post rotating.
Shot clock starting to wind down. Staten knows it. That pass deflected and stolen away. For the most part, the Mountaineers have taken good care of the ball. That discrepancy in points off of turnovers has been a huge difference in this game. It's been the difference. Turner from the baseline. Beautiful touch for the freshman.
Well, they found the soft spot in the zone because it's a 1-1-3. The wings are lifted out. They flash Turner to the short corner. The nice pass right there. And at 6'11", he has a quick release and a soft touch from 15 to 17 feet.
And a good point by you. Rick Barnes was screaming at Miles Turner to get to that exact spot the whole possession. He finally got there. They got him the ball, and he had a wide open look.
Yeah, because the middle guy in the zone can't rotate out to him quick enough.
Williams fumbles the ball, gets it back, makes his move, and draws a foul. A little ragged there, but Devin Williams will be at the free throw line when we come back. We got a good one going here in Morgantown. Dave Fleming, Miles Simon back here in Morgantown. 45-40, that's the West Virginia lead over Texas with 10.5 to go. Let's talk some bracketology with our own bracketology expert, Joe Lunardi. Nobody better at predicting who's going to be in, who's going to be out. Joe, we have talked a lot tonight about the stakes on both sides in this particular matchup. Feels like for the Longhorns, they're down 5. If they lose this game, are people in Austin right to start to get a little bit nervous about a spot in the tournament?
I would have been nervous
before tonight
if I was in Austin,
guys.
When you talk about Texas at this point,
you're looking at a team that's
at risk of falling 3 games under 500
in their own league
with an easy trip to Kansas coming up.
That would put them potentially
4 games under 500.
And only once
in the history of the at-large field as a team, 4 games under 500 in their own league, gotten an at-large bid before.
Joe, well, speaking of the Jayhawks, after what happened last night in Manhattan, Kansas, I know the Jayhawks have been on the 2-seed line, you know, for the past few weeks for you. What are the chances that the Jayhawks, if they can share or win the Big 12 and then maybe the Big 12 tournament, what are their chances of moving up to the 1-seed?
I think there are too many teams, Miles, now in front of Kansas for them to get up to the top line. I think there's also a basketball element to this is I don't think they're as good as those other teams, and we saw them exposed a little bit last night. It's not a knock. I think they've been overachieving most of the season, and it's been a great job by Bill Self and those players. Now it's a question of can they win enough to stay on the two line, because they're more likely to go down at this point than move back up.
West Virginia up 7-10-16 to go. A few minutes here with Joe Lunardi, our bracketologist, talking Big 12, talking these two teams. Joe, you've got West Virginia firmly in, projected as a 6-seed right now. You've got 7 of the 10 Big 12 teams in the field as of this moment. Is there any chance, Miles referenced the win for Kansas State last night, any chance the Wildcats could work their way to where they're even in consideration, a bubble team, so to speak?
They would need another couple of big wins here in the regular season. The schedule allows for that. And then they would probably need to at least reach the championship game of the Big 12 tournament. And if this were to happen, and there were times earlier in January when we had eight Big 12 teams in the projected field, 8 out of 10, 80% would be far and away the highest bid percentage for any league in any one season, even ahead of those larger numeric years out of the Big East, for instance. A few years ago got 11, but it was out of 16 candidates.
Hey, Joe, and speaking of a bigger picture question for you, if we're looking at the number one seeds right now that you have projected in Duke and Virginia and Kentucky and Gonzaga, which of those teams is the most vulnerable to fall off that line going into Selection Sunday?
I would have to say Gonzaga for two reasons, Miles. Number one, we don't really know how the committee will value the Zags vis-a-vis the teams from the other power conferences. And number two, any loss that Gonzaga would suffer would be viewed as a bad loss in the eyes of the committee. Whereas, you know, a Duke can lose in Chapel Hill, or a Virginia can lose to a Duke, and they're beating up on one another. For Gonzaga, a loss means all thought of a top-line finish kind of goes by the boards.
We're chatting here with Joe Lunardi, our own bracketology expert. Joe has been better than anybody in the business at projecting who's in, who's out. What, 5 years, five teams total that you haven't picked correctly for the field. That's pretty impressive. West Virginia, meanwhile, with the three and a Texas timeout. So the Mountaineers are up by 10 with 9:15 to go. Miles asked you about those one seeds that are vulnerable. We got Wisconsin playing opposite us as we speak in College Park. Joe, are the Badgers the team best positioned to make that jump up to the one line?
I think so, but we could also see Villanova be the team that's knocking on the door as number five overall if Wisconsin doesn't rally at Maryland and the Wildcats hold on as they appear to in a Big East game at home against Providence. The Wildcats have kind of been under the radar, but both their conference and non-conference resumes are very, very strong.
All right, Joe, we appreciate the time. Always enjoy talking to you. Keep up the great work. We will be following your every word from now until Selection Sunday. Thanks for giving us a few minutes.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, Joe.
So Joe Lunardi, and we wanted to talk to Joe. Here we're coming down the home stretch of this Big 12 conference, which has been so, so competitive. Juwan Steen, we noticed him limping a moment ago, and he's going to come to the bench here before we get back to action with 9:15 to play. The Mountaineers are in a very good position. Texas, you heard Joe say, the Longhorns are precarious. They're not going to be feeling real comfortable if this game ends up as a loss. Now, the Longhorns would be three games under 500 in conference play with a game Saturday in Lawrence against the Jayhawks.
And would almost be truly shocking because of the high expectations when you have Miles Turner and you have so many guys returning off a team that went to the NCAA tournament last year, won a game in the tournament. As you see the good ball movement, but Taylor not able to knock down the three. And remember, they gave Kentucky a tough game in Rupp earlier this season without Isaiah Taylor. And it was a team that was just on such a high. They started the season 11-2. But I almost feel that the turnaround game was when they lost at Stanford, I mean, at home against Stanford, right before the Christmas break, and Stanford had to came back in the second half and had an outstanding game in a game that I covered.
Offensive rebound for Holton and the Mountaineers. So a 10-point lead, a 10-2 run from West Virginia has really changed the feel of this one. Texas had all the momentum in this game. No longer. Holton from the corner. Three is good.
When Jonathan Holton can stay on the floor for this West Virginia team, he's such a factor because he's so good on the defensive end, heading the press, and he's versatile on the offensive end.
Turner baseline, no good. Holton tapped it to Miles, who outlets it. Beautiful pass to Carter.
And I don't know why Carter would skip it over to Devin Williams right there. Devin Williams not going to do anything behind the arc. But now they'll get into the offense as Texas goes to the man-to-man.
Longhorns are in trouble here tonight. Williams long two. Holton again gets his hand on the ball, but this time Ridley comes away with a defensive board.
How about the shift to the zone by Bob Huggins? I mean, this is why this guy has won over 700 games in his career, the third winningest active coach in the NCAA, able to make adjustments on the fly for the benefit of this Mountaineers team, and has changed the momentum of this basketball game in the second half.
Well, two big games on Saturday night on ESPN. First at 7 in the ACC, Syracuse and Duke. Part of Bracket Builder Week presented by Dish, and then Arizona, Utah. That's another big one. 9 Eastern on Saturday in the Pac-12. Clearly the two best teams in that league. Arizona maybe their best chance to lose remaining in the regular season. Rick Barnes, meanwhile, in the last timeout, huddled up with his team. Let's take a listen.
Rebound. You guys got to go get the ball. You got to put a body on the floor. Whoever, you guys got to jump. Now look,
Fair
we're right here.
Time for tonight's Coca-Cola.
Well, we always enjoy the coaches giving us a little access, insight into the huddle. Rick Barnes' team made a valiant comeback in this game. They were down 18 with about 4 minutes to go in the first half. They cut the lead down to 2 when it was 40-38. Since then, 13-2 run for West Virginia, and the Mountaineers are back in control of this game with 6:56 to go. On the inbound play, nice play. Yancey scores easily, and Bob Huggins, 700-plus wins, will not be happy about that.
Yeah, really nice play out of that timeout. They cleared out the backside, and then just a quick flash by Yancey and the beautiful pass and the finish.
Elijah Macon has not played big minutes tonight. Misses that shot. Rebound Longhorns. We'll see if Texas has one final push left in them. Taylor going to the basket, and they will call that a shooting foul. So he'll get 2 free throws.
Taylor, one of the fastest guys in the country with that basketball. I mean, when he got that outlet, he was almost like he was shot out of a cannon going, trying to go coast to coast. Nobody stops the ball.
Now, Taylor missed 10 games. He broke 3 bones in his wrist earlier this year, and that has been a factor in his season. But I think even considering that, it's been a disappointing year for the sophomore. He was tremendous as a freshman last year. There are a lot of folks who thought he would take a big leap forward this year. It has not happened, but he makes both free throws.
Well, I think with the injury kind of screwed with the continuity of this team, and they were obviously playing so well early on, you know, in November into early December, and then he had to come back, and as almost the team was doing so well, you come back and you almost feel forced to try to fit in and pick up right where you left off, and it's just taken some time for Isaiah Taylor.
He's played pretty well tonight. And the lead is back down to 9. Brown to the basket, had it stripped away. Yancey's on the court, but Taylor, that speed Miles was just talking about, no good, but draws the foul. Kendall Yancey almost wobbly as he gets up. He says he's okay.
Well, he's being a guard right there, and he just trips over his own guy. And then I think Gary Brown's either foot or shin caught him as he's going by. He takes a little blow to the head, but Yancey seems to be okay.
The foul on this end was against Javon Carter. That's his 3rd. So back to the free throw line for Taylor in the long runs. He makes another one. Ridley back in the game for Texas. Taylor into double figures. He's got 10 points to go with the 5 assists. A 6-0 run for the Longhorns. Not going away on the road. A win that would help Texas tremendously.
It's great when you can have a guy like Juwan Staten with the speed and the smarts that he plays with, able to dribble out of that pressure and get West Virginia into the half-court offense.
It's not been a big night statistically for State. There's the reigning Big 12 Player of the Week. Miles attacks, shot rejected. Miles then almost came up with the steal after the missed shot, but he commits a foul. Juwan Staten, meanwhile, sort of limping around as he goes back to the other end, but more free throws for Texas.
Well, Miles makes two mistakes there. One, he gets in too deep against the number one shot blocking team in the country, and they come and swarm and take away anything that he has. He has to draw the defenders to him and then be able to make a pass to an open teammate. And then he complicates the problem because he tried to make up for it as he fouls Connor Lambert.
Lambert earns a second free throw.
Lambert really much improved over last season. Coach Barnes told him in the offseason, if you really want to be a force, the things that people say about you is that you're a little bit soft, and he went and got stronger. He's become a better rebounder, and he's been much more active and an integral part of this Texas Longhorn team as they're able to beat the press with ease.
Miles with the dunk. So Texas trying to give West Virginia a taste of its own medicine, but the Mountaineers easily break the pressure.
What an inbounds pass right there to have your eyes up and look deep and find the home run ball. Similar to what they did against TCU.
It was the other direction. It was Miles to Carter in that instance. This time Carter to Miles. Turner down the lane, or Taylor rather. Rebound West Virginia. And here comes Carter attacking. Carter missed the shot. Holland all the way. Holland, a pushing foul on Carter. And that's going to get the fans angry.
Well, here's a great job. Texas kind of in a scramble mode as Holton flashes forward. Isaiah Taylor goes with him, and he loses Daxter Miles, and then the pass delivered right on the money from Carter.
Well, Carter just committed his fourth personal foul, so I think he's going to be coming out of this game. Double bonus time for Texas. They're not making free throws. They missed 5 out of 15. Carter does go to the bench. Holland makes 1 of 2. The lead is 6. And we're going to see the Longhorns try this full court pressure again.
Well, and here's where you really miss Jonathan Holmes. He could be in the game at the 4 spot helping with this pressure. A good athlete with long arms and excellent size and another body that kind of gives you a breather. They had to obviously shorten their bench here in the second half, and you get a little bit worn down going against West Virginia.
Holmes was called for a flagrant 2 foul at the end of the first half. Ejected by rule from this game. Now whistle and what? Shot clock is not working properly. Here's what we were talking about. Jonathan Holmes, senior, one of the leaders for the Longhorns, got pushed from behind, retaliated with the elbow, knocked Devin Williams to the floor. They reviewed it at the monitor. And Holmes called for a flagrant 2 foul, ejected in that final minute of the first half. So this, to me, I think is a timing issue. Officials are at the table. And I guess they want to look at it to try to manually determine what the clock should read.
Well, it's amazing. As you would think that West Virginia has pretty much been in control and leading for 99% of this basketball game. You know, you look up at the score and Texas is only down 2 possessions. If they can get a stop here and try to get a quick score, I mean, there is obviously a lot of time left in this basketball game.
So it's both the game clock and the shot clock that stopped. And so presumably they're going to just roll this real time, count manually, and then start the game with the clock set at the proper figures on both ends. And this should not take very long. Just do the count, tell them what the clock should read, and that's what we're going to do. 4:32 remaining, 15 seconds on the shot clock. West Virginia, if they can win this game, now their schedule is not easy by any means. They have to go to Baylor. They're going to stay on the road after Saturday's game against a good Baylor team. And then they'll play against Kansas a week from tonight in Lawrence. Come back home to finish against Oklahoma State. There is a look at the end of the regular season schedule for the Mountaineers.
And you and I will be there in Lawrence next Tuesday.
But if they win this game and somehow come up with a win in Waco, imagine the stakes a week from tonight on both sides. It's going to be a really important game no matter what. Ridley blocks his shot, but they call a foul.
And State's really hurting. he's kind of just trying to tough it out here in the last 4 minutes. I mean, he goes a straight line drive there all the way to the rim, but he comes up wincing right away. And here you go, Staten with the drive, get by the little hesitation there. And it looks like he kicked the toe of Connor Lambert there, and that's why he's coming up a little bit lame.
Yeah, this is an ongoing thing, though, with Juwan Staten. He's been limping around for a good portion of this game. Two shots for Staten. This is the first. Well, every time you feel like West Virginia is pulling away, has the game under total control, not the case. And this game is far from over. Makes one of two. And no pressure from the Mountaineers.
No, they've been okay just staying in this zone here in the second half.
Texas is the one team all year that really has forced West Virginia out of that total havoc full court pressure.
Well, Texas has given them problems even going back to last year, and I know it's a completely different Mountaineer team, but Texas has won four straight against West Virginia.
And they've all, before tonight, been blowouts in favor of the Longhorns. That was a good look for Kendall Yancey. Missed the shot. So West Virginia ball, and I think content to be patient on offense.
And I'm surprised we're not seeing Miles Turner on the floor against this zone. He's a guy that can knock down threes. We've seen him knock down the mid-range jumper.
Staten right through traffic. What a move. Didn't finish. Williams on the offensive glass. Jump ball. And the arrow favors West Virginia. That's great hustle by the big man, Devin Williams. Timeout in Morgantown. Mountaineers trying to hang on. Our journey to the tourney presented by Sonic continues Saturday, and it is a very big game in the Missouri Valley. Two top 11 teams, number 10 Northern Iowa, 2 Wichita, to take on the Shockers, number 11 of the country, Saturday 2 Eastern on ESPN. Meanwhile, here tonight, West Virginia, Miles, a far cry from January 17th in Austin, where their offense was putrid against the Longhorns. The offense has played well tonight.
Yeah, they really couldn't handle the size of this Texas team. And obviously, I mentioned it earlier, Texas, one of the best defensive teams in the country as far as field goal percentage defense goes. But West Virginia, different story tonight. And really the difference, Dave, is kind of the first 6 to 7 minutes of this game, when against the zone, West Virginia was tremendously effective getting the ball inside, setting up their pressure, getting turnovers, and taking Texas out of anything and everything they wanted to do on the offensive end.
And maybe some of you just joining us here in Morgantown, Dave Fleming, Miles Simon, after a huge win for Maryland at home against a top 5 Wisconsin team. This has been a wild game. West Virginia was up big in the first half, really dominating. Texas came all the way back, was down only 2, still fairly early in the second half. But the Mountaineers have gone on a push. Devin Williams out of the timeout, misses the shot. Holton goes over the back. Texas in the double bonus. More free throws coming for the Longhorns, and they need to make these free throws down the stretch. 3:18 to go. They can cut into the lead.
And I almost feel that was a shot that was not needed. It was a fresh shot clock for Devin Williams. Time and score is on your side if you're the West Virginia Mountaineers. You're up 7 points. 3.5 minutes left. You don't have to shoot within the first 5 seconds of the shot clock. A contested jump hook against Cameron Ridley.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you. Shot not needed and foul not needed either. Lambert makes the first.
Well, you have to get a lot of credit to Connor Lambert of doing a good job of screening out one of the best offensive rebounders in the Big 12, Michael Holton, and getting him on his back.
He's made all 4 of his free throws. Texas will set up pressure. It's a 5-point game. Staten with that knee still bugging him a little bit. Nice pass to get out of the trap. Different game situation. I think West Virginia attacks right there and tries to get a bucket.
Yeah, but I think Gary Brown, he's smart. He's been around. He's played in some big games. Brings it back out. Able to use time to score. And Juwan Staten, he's holding that thigh area and kind of limping around, dragging his left leg.
Yeah, I mean, he's dealt with a knee problem this year. I'm not sure that's what's going on here tonight. Brown will draw a foul.
But Juwan Staten, as tough as they come in the college game. and I don't think he's going to let Bob Huggins take him out. He's going to have to be dragged off this court.
He had a wrist issue earlier in the year when he took a very hard fall, landed right on his wrist, and played that game and made some big plays in that game.
Well, and he made the biggest shot of the West Virginia season last Monday on Big Monday, going coast to coast and making the spin move layup to beat the Kansas Jayhawks.
Nathan Adrian will come in. First free throw good for Gary Brown. The senior leader for the Mountaineers. Preseason Big 12 player of the year. He's probably not going to be the Big 12 player of the year. But that doesn't mean he hasn't been a huge part of the Mountaineers' success.
And knowing Juwan State, spending some time around him this summer at the LeBron James camp, he's not about that. After the frustrating year last year where the Mountaineers just struggled, he just wants to win basketball games and make some noise in the NCAA tournament.
Yancey, three, in and out. Lambert got his hands on the ball and draws another foul.
Lambert doing a good job of being active on both ends of the floor.
Again, these free throws are so important for Texas. Longhorns have done a much better job in the second half taking care of the ball. Free throw no good. Last 15 times they've had it, only one Texas turnover. Now West Virginia switched their defense a little bit because the Longhorns were having some success. But still, they have done a nice job. That free throw makes it a 6-point lead. Carter with his four fouls. The freshman back in. Adrian comes out.
Now, if I'm Texas in this case and I'm seeing Juwan Staten limp around the court, I almost want him to catch the ball because his speed has been a little bit neutralized with the injury.
Staten double team finds Williams open. And Williams on the move, the runner no good. Holton gets the offensive rebound and scores.
They're well below their average tonight. That's only their ninth offensive rebound for a team that averages 17 per game, but that might be the biggest one of the evening.
Taylor out of control, misses the shot. Williams gets rid of the ball. And I think Texas needs a foul. So far, haven't been able to do it. Brown gets fouled by Lambert. Finally.
And here you see Holton just getting to the weak side. And Bob Huggins has a philosophy on offensive rebounds. Get inside of your man and opposite of where the ball was shot. Holton does that to perfection. Bob Huggins explained to us a few weeks ago that about 70 to 75% of shots are going to go to the opposite side from where they're released, and Jonathan Holton uses that to his advantage there and able to get the finish.
Front end of the 1-1 for Gary Brown. Makes the first. Well, that replay was a perfect example of it because Holton literally, as the shot was going up, made sure he shuffled his way over to the weak side, and he was right there when the ball came down.
See, now they're bringing in Miles Turner, who I thought they could have brought in a little early, a few minutes ago, to bring in some outside shooting, a guy who's a threat on from the three-point line.
Gary Brown, who played so well on the road against Oklahoma State in West Virginia's big win over this last weekend. Quieter night tonight, but he makes two big free throws.
Yeah, not only was he scoring, he had 18 points, but he did a great job on Phil Forte, really chasing him around and making Forte work for each and every point that he got.
Javon Carter, the freshman, hounding Holland as he brings the ball up across midcourt. Lambert with a pass fake and hits a three. That's a big shot. Rick Barnes will call the timeout. So Connor Lambert, who did get the start tonight for Texas, with a big bucket.
Well, I love Lambert's composure right here. The pass fake, Adrian jumps, that frees up enough space for Lambert to get off the deep three.
Well, we did mention Javon Carter of West Virginia. We are going to call him our sixth man of the game, brought to you by Motel 6. Number's not huge. Foul trouble has limited his minutes, but when he's been in the game, Miles, he's played really well.
Well, he's a guy, if he's knocking down three-point shots, he shoots a little over 30% on the season. Kind of keeps the floor spread so they can operate on the inside, and that gives Juwan Staten some driving lanes.
That was the first basket that Texas has made from the field in 5.5 minutes. They have gotten a lot of offense at the free throw line, but just not quite enough, it doesn't feel like, tonight for the Longhorns, barring a miracle. And if they lose this game, Texas will be 6-9 in conference play, with their next game at Allen Fieldhouse over the weekend against Kansas looming, that possibility of a 6-10 conference record for the Longhorns, with still a couple of games to play before the Big 12 tournament.
And the road not easy for any of those top four teams, as Kansas is going to play Texas next at home, play West Virginia at home, and then has to finish at Oklahoma.
Not a great pass there. It's off of Texas, though, so West Virginia keeps it. Well, we've been talking about that note. Only one team has made the tournament for the Big 12 in history with a sub-500 conference record. That was last year, some extenuating circumstances with Marcus Smart missing that chunk in the middle of the conference season for the Cowboys. But Texas still, they have good win. They beat Iowa, they beat Cal, they went on the road and beat UConn. They have a good win against West Virginia. They have close losses against good teams. It's not like their resume has nothing of quality on it. But if you're that far below 500 in the league, you're going to be a bubble team. Selection Sunday is not going to be comfortable.
Yeah, West Virginia is their only top 50 RPI win, and they've had plenty of chances, obviously, in the league. And as we explained earlier, you know, five of their six conference wins are against the bottom three teams of the Big 12. So they're still trying to find some more marquee and signature wins. But that's the great thing about the Big 12, either in their last few games or going into the conference tournament, Texas is going to have some opportunities over these next 3 weeks to try to solidify that resume and keep themselves off the bubble and in the NCAA tournament.
A minute 21 to go. Juwan Staten and West Virginia breaking that pressure. Now a foul behind the play by DeMarcus Holland. Hey, that's what Texas wanted. After they didn't get the steal, you got to stop the clock and force the Mountaineers to earn it at the free throw line. They've been very good at the line tonight, 13-15. This is not normally a good West Virginia free throw shooting team, right around 65% as a team on the year, but tonight they've been solid. Front end for Devin Williams. Good. If they lose this game, and then, look, we don't know what will happen in Lawrence. Maybe Texas comes up with a huge win and everything feels totally different. But if they lose that game, they are 6-10 in conference play. They get two home games as Holton goes over the back, and Bob Huggins just cannot believe it. You can't do that.
Yeah, and that's just not a smart play. And those are some of the reasons that Jonathan Holton has been in foul trouble in so many games this year, just silly fouls. Your team is up 8 points with a minute 18 left, and now you're sending arguably Texas' best foul shooter to the line in Miles Turner, a chance to score 2 points without the clock running, and then for Texas to be able to set up a press. Holton has to be much smarter than that in that situation.
Turner, a rare miss for him at the free throw line. Seven points tonight for Miles Turner. Here comes more pressure. Gary Brown, the inbounder. Carter had it stolen away by Taylor. And a nice dish to Yancey, who missed the wide open layup. Now Carter stepped on the end line, but that was 2 points for the Longhorns.
What a play by Isaiah Taylor to steal that basketball and then alertly attack and get the layup for Kendall Yancey, and he just misses it off the rim.
Turner might have gotten away with one. He just pushed Devin Williams right in the face. Taylor draws contact, scores with the foul. What a play by Isaiah Taylor.
Amazing body control by Isaiah Taylor right here. He gets going to the left hand. He loves driving left, going off the left foot, draws the contact from Holton, and able to adjust in the air and bank it off the glass and get it to go in. And now a chance to cut it to 4 points with a minute four left.
And that'll be number five against Holton, so he's disqualified from the game.
And almost this whole sequence goes back to Jonathan Holton fouling on the Devin Williams missed free throw. That has allowed for all this action to happen on this end of the floor for the Longhorns.
He is a good player. He plays hard. His teammates love him. He cannot keep committing these fouls. It has been so costly for West Virginia and for him personally this year.
Well, Huggins told us today he has to just play smarter.
104 to go. The lead is four. Not over. West Virginia. Carter on the inbound.
Now, if you're Texas, you can play this possession out defensively, but smart play, scouted. That's a scouted report foul, knowing that Devin Williams, one of the worst foul shooters at only 66%, and he missed his last one for the Mountaineers.
So they got the ball out of the hands of Carter, out of the hands of Staten, into the hands of Williams. And it's still 1-1 for the last time. Double bonus after this. Front end.
Well, if you're West Virginia, make or miss, get back on defense, set up, and you have to make the Longhorns use some clock. Don't let Isaiah Taylor get going downhill, get all the way to the rim with a quick basket or a kick out for a wide open three.
There's some token pressure from Carter. Taylor's really turned it up. Lambert from the baseline misses the two, so that's the worst of all worlds. But Holland gets the rebound, puts it back in. Quick timeout for Texas. Back to a four-point lead.
And I still feel that they scored too fast. West Virginia defense not good enough in that case. Lambert had an open shot, and then the offensive rebound put back as the Longhorns surrounded the paint. See the nice pass. Miles Turner working on the offensive end. He gets the little deflection, was able to knock the ball to DeMarcus Holland.
65-61. It's been an unusual game. Texas was down 18 in the first half. Looked like they were just going to be run out of Morgantown. But bridging the final couple minutes, even when one of their stars, Jonathan Alms, was ejected for the game after a flagrant two foul. Bridging the first half and the second half, Longhorns got right back in this thing. They were down two with plenty of time to go. West Virginia back ahead by double figures and seemed like they were going to cruise to a win, but some Mountaineers mistakes, some nice plays by Taylor and company, and Bob Huggins is going to have to sweat out the final 42 seconds.
For those that weren't watching the beginning of this basketball game, that's almost where the difference was decided, when West Virginia was on attack and opened up that big double-digit lead in the first half, and it's been an uphill climb for the Longhorns ever since the first 6 or 7 minutes of this game.
Williams fouled again, this time by Miles Turner, so Devin Williams will go back to the free throw line. Texas is doing a good job. They're extending this game.
And I think they're forcing the catch to the guy that they want shooting the free throws. They don't want Brown or Carter or Staten at the line. And Devin Williams has been the guy that he's kind of been the pressure release for this against the press.
When we're finished, NBA Coast to Coast follows us. Williams looking more comfortable at the free throw line. Nice game for him, 13 points. A critical player for an undersized West Virginia team. He made a both.
Now you still don't need the three, not a forced three. You want to penetrate if you get a kick out for a three, but otherwise try to score at the rim and then be able to set up your pressure.
Yancey couldn't get the shot off. Too much time ticking off for Texas. Holland does get a three off and hits it.
And excuse me for saying not to shoot a contested three, as DeMarcus Holland able to catch and shoot and knock it down with a hand in his face.
Well, I do think after 10 plus seconds had ticked off, there was some urgency there.
Well, West Virginia actually did a good job of scrambling. Gary Brown, hands were a little bit down. Holland with the quick release, a 44% three-point shooter on the season. Cashes in.
This has been a lopsided head-to-head matchup in recent history between these two teams and in favor of Texas. Very different feel to this game. Last four games this year and last year, 18 points a game. The Longhorns are 4-0 against the Mountaineers. So for West Virginia, trying to sort of get the monkey off their back, this has been the team in the Big 12 that has given West Virginia more problems the last couple of years than anybody.
Yeah, they definitely have. And looking at this next possession here on the defense, we're going to see obviously full court pressure. And if you're Texas now, with it being a one possession game and 26 and a half seconds left, you could go ahead and try to trap the first pass, try to force the turnover. You don't have to give the foul right away if you're the Longhorns. Try to get the steal if you're Isaiah Taylor, play the passing lanes, and then if they break the press and get it across half court, then you give the foul.
And I do think that a part of this game that has been fascinating down the stretch is West Virginia's been the team that sort of backed away from their all-out pressure. It's been Texas, the team that has, by necessity, but still, the Longhorns have been in the full court press mode these last few minutes. And maybe that's helped the Longhorns. Even if they haven't generated a lot of turnovers, play with a little more urgency.
Well, I don't think in the last couple of minutes West Virginia has necessarily had a chance to run offense because it's been a parade to the foul line for the most part. The one time that they did try to score is Jonathan Holton ended up getting that offensive rebound and the putback.
Well, Texas still has plenty of time to go for a steal, maybe once, maybe twice, take a few gambles. And then you got to get a foul on because the shot clock is off.
You definitely want a trap or two in the backcourt. Give yourself a chance to get the steal.
Well, there's one clock that's correct here in the arena. One is not. So they're just making sure everybody knows, don't look up at the big scoreboard. That clock is wrong. The clock above the shot clocks, the official clock, is correct. Brown gets it in. Staten as Yancey falls down. Two on one. Carter will score. Man, you had to make that one. If you're going to shoot, it better go in. Yancey gets off a three. No good. Holland out of bounds off of DeMarcus Holland.
Texas, because of the slip and the fall, allows for a two-on-one advantage at the other end. And Staten handles it perfectly as the Mountaineers score and increase it to five.
Williams, a nifty little play to pass it right back to Brown. That bought West Virginia another second off the clock. It'll be Brown to the free throw line with 6 seconds to go. And this one all but over.
You have to give the Texas Longhorns a ton of credit for fighting and scratching and clawing back in this basketball game and making it a one-possession game with about 25 seconds left to go, but just not enough at the end.
Free throw good from Gary Brown. Close loss at home to Iowa State. Close loss on the road last week in Norman against a very good Oklahoma team. Now a close game. And what looks like a loss for Texas here at West Virginia. But no consolation. The Longhorns are in trouble. Final seconds. Holland air ball. Horn sounds at West Virginia. Dominated by Texas earlier this year. They bounce back against the Longhorns to get an impressive win. And you see those records, Miles, 10-5 in conference play. West Virginia is one game behind Kansas for first place in this league.
And they have a chance to play the Jayhawks next Tuesday night, a big game at Fog Allen Fieldhouse.
So the final stretch of Big 12 play going to be very dramatic. 71-64, the final for Miles. Dave Fleming saying so long. NBA coast to coast comes up next.